Simon & Schuster Audio presents Hoax by Robert K. Tanenbaum. Read by Lee Sellars.
It was one of those lovely early June evenings in New York City, when the new leaves on the trees were still lime green, and the salt air was blowing in from the harbor, fresh and warm as a cup of espresso at the Ferrara Cafe on Grand Street. Several blocks west of that 100-year-old institution, Roger Karp stood with his twin sons on the sidewalk where Grand crossed Crosby, where his family lived in a top-floor loft, soaking in the last rays of the setting sun. Giancarlo had his face turned to the west like a sunflower, smiling serenely behind dark Ray Charles glasses. But Zach was obviously troubled, frowning and kicking at the curb. Finally, he said, "I still don't understand why that baby had to die. Why does God let good people die and bad people live?" The question caught Karp, Butch to all who knew him, the current district attorney for the county of New York, off guard. Several weeks earlier, the 11-year-old boys had surprised him by asking if they could study for the bar mitzvah, the rite of passage into manhood for Jewish boys, and then he'd surprised himself even more by agreeing to help them. The whole family seemed to have embarked on spiritual quests. His wife, Marlene Ciampi, and their daughter, Lucy, were trying to find themselves in the New Mexican desert. And now the boys. But he didn't consider himself to be on particularly good terms with God, dating back to the death of his mother when he was in high school. "Yet here I am, left to field questions from the twins that I don't know if I have the answers to," he thought. They discussed the biblical story of David and Bathsheba, in which God caused the couple's firstborn son to die because of their sins. The boys thought that was unfair to the baby, and Karp didn't really have the answer to their complaints, as he thought so too. He tried to show that it was a story about actions having sometimes unforeseen consequences, and thought he'd made his point. However, Zach was obviously still troubled, and Karp wanted to say something meaningful. "I don't really know, Zach," he said. "All I can say is that there seems to be a sort of economy to the world, a sort of balancing act. I don't even know if there's a grand plan to all of it, or if that's just the way it is, but maybe, in that economy, there's a reason why bad things happen to good people, even if it also hurts the people who love them." His answer came to an abrupt end when a dark blue Lincoln town car pulled up to the curb and a large, muscular black man in a suit got out. Clay Fulton was the chief of the NYPD detectives who were assigned to the district attorney's office as investigators. The twins, who'd known him all their lives, were delighted with his arrival, and immediately started peppering him with requests for a tale about taking on the bad guys single-handedly.
"Can't tonight. Got to talk a little business with your dad," he said, making eye contact with Karp to let him know what he had to say wasn't for the twins' ears.
Karp sent the disappointed boys in to do their homework and turned to Fulton. They were both big men. The DA may be a little taller at 6'5", most of it still in decent shape despite the debilitating demon, middle age, and a bum knee from an old basketball injury. Fulton was 20 pounds heavier, though all of it was lean muscle as it had been back in his playing days as a middle linebacker for Penn State.
"What's up?" Karp asked. "They've made an arrest in that quadruple homicide," Fulton said.
The Los Angeles rap star ML Rex and his buddy, plus two hookers, had been gunned down on a Saturday night 10 days earlier while sitting in a limousine in East Harlem. It was a bloodbath that had all the earmarks of a gangland hit. The twins had filled Karp in on the particulars of gangster rap and the simmering conflict between the East Coast and the West Coast rap camps. Some sort of modern-day Hatfields and McCoys, he gathered, only this feud was conducted with assault rifles and semi-automatic handguns. One of the mysteries had been cleared up when the detectives tracked down the limousine driver, who'd been lying low, too frightened of retaliation to come forward. As if Fulton knew what he was thinking, the detective said,
"The chauffeur says he saw the whole thing go down. Identified the suspect in a lineup. We're good to go."
"So who'd they call her?"
"A local rapper named Alejandro Garcia. Apparently, the two exchanged death threats at the hip-hop club on West 38th Street the night before the murders. The detectives who picked him up told me he had a rep as a real hard case."
Karp frowned. Alejandro Garcia. He thought he'd heard the name before, but he couldn't place it.
"Garcia lawyered up?" Karp asked Fulton. "Nope. but he hadn't said much other than he had nothing to do with it. "Give me a minute to get the boys settled, and let's go down to the tombs and see if he'll chat with me," Karp said. He turned for the door when Fulton mumbled something about there being something else. "Yeah, what is it?" "It seems that the twins, Zach and Giancarlo, were also present during the altercation at the club. In fact, they may have been in the middle of it." It was 11 days earlier, and the air in the hip-hop nightclub pulsed to the repetitive throbbing of a bass guitar as two spotlights met at center stage and focused on a pair of young men, one black and one Hispanic. They were handed microphones by the master of ceremonies like 18th-century duelists accepting pistols. But instead of 10 paces turn and fire, they stood 2 feet apart, glaring at each other. 6 inches taller than his counterpart, black rap musician ML Rex wore a loose muscle shirt to show off a bevy of thick gold chains and tattoos meant to impress the bitches and the busters. His left shoulder bore a tattoo of the numerals 1078, the police radio 10 code for Officer Needs Assistance. The inference was that he was a cop killer, though he'd never actually had the balls to shoot at someone who was ready to shoot back. Drive-bys and firing indiscriminately into crowds had been more his style back in the street gang days with the Bloods of Los Angeles. But the 1078 tat went with the gangster rap image he cultivated. Despite the look of impending violence on his face as he stared down at the teenager in front of him, ML Rex was in a great mood. Some of that had to do with the 2 fat lines of cocaine he'd snorted backstage. But his ebullience had even more to do with a business meeting that morning with his record label's executives. The way he saw it, Pentagram's failure to pour more money into promoting his hit CD had cost him a platinum record and his rightful place in the hip-hop hierarchy. So he'd come up with the idea of forming his own record company. His business manager, childhood friend, and fellow blood, Kwasama Zigzag Jones, had protested the move, but his pleas fell on deaf ears. ML Rex expected that Pentagram executives, a bunch of white faggots in suits, wouldn't be too happy with his declaration of independence. So he was surprised when he and Jones met with them that morning, and the company president merely agreed and insisted that ML Rex continue to avail himself of Vincent, the bodyguard chauffeur the company had arranged for him. "We want your trip to New York to continue to be a safe one," the man said with a smile. "You never know. We might work together again sometime." The executive's friendly response had hurt the rapper's ego. He'd expected them to make a bigger fuss over losing a rising star of his caliber. "Fuck those motherfuckers," he told Jones as they left the building. "Fucking with my head. That's what they're trying to do." Several hours and 2 grams of cocaine later, ML Rex was feeling better about how he'd stood up to the man. Still, he was happy to retain the services of Vincent, a huge white man he assumed was some sort of mobbed-up Italian. ML Rex looked over at Zigzag, who was standing off stage with his arms around the 2 hookers they'd procured for the night. The girls were a couple of Puerto Rican sisters who, high on crack and sure of a big payday, gyrated their hips and shook their breasts to the beat. "Yes," Rex thought as he glared down at his competition. "Life is good." In the morning, he would work out a new deal with a national music distributor. To really make it big, he realized, he was going to have to move away from his West Coast-centric roots and go for a national audience. That was the reason he was going through with this appearance arranged by Pentagram to a round of battle rhyming against one of the local rappers. Battle rhyming, essentially 2 opponents competing with lyrics to win over a live audience, was the roots of rap. It was part asphalt poetry, reflective of life in a ghetto, and part clever and generally good-natured put-downs, a way of establishing sidewalk supremacy without anything worse than someone's ego getting hurt. It had been a long time since ML Rex had participated in a battle, and he wasn't thinking as clearly as he'd have liked, his brain fogged by cocaine. He was therefore relieved when he was introduced to his opponent, a short, stocky Puerto Rican teen who looked like he didn't even know how to dress himself. "If this little spick's what passes for a gangster in New York City," he thought, "I got shit to worry about." The self-assurance, however, evaporated as he stared in his opponent's eyes. He didn't know what it was, but there was something about the other young man's gaze that rattled him. The teen didn't seem to need them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.